Rev up your engines!
They bought this car 12 years ago for a dollar. She bought it from her mother. And so for a dollar, they've got a lot of mileage out of this car. This one wasn't even made in Japan, it was made in Ohio. And the pink elephant is hiding the check engine light. So let's get into this. We got out the old scan tool, plug it in. Now the codes at start is P1167. Heated oxygen sensor, sensor one, heater failure. Look at the freeze frame data, which shows all the information about it, when it happened. The engine RPM was 1335, the speed was zero. So it happened when this thing was started up cold. Now, the oxygen sensors are heated up electronically so the car pollutes less upon initial startup. If it waited till it warmed up, it might take a minute or two, so this is a very small anti-pollution thing to make it be warmed up faster. So let's look at the data the sensor's giving up. As you can see, it's a 21-year-old car, but the short-term fuel trim is zero. The long-term fuel trim is zero. This thing runs like a clock. Now here's the output from the oxygen sensor. We'll rev it up a little. As you notice, it's not changing at all. Even though the code is for the heated oxygen sensor, problem with the heater, it's more than that because the sensor itself is not working correctly. Here's the graph I've graphed. And if you know anything about oxygen sensors, this graph should be going up and down and up and down. It's flatlined. It is doing absolutely nothing. And it doesn't even matter if we rev it up and down. It should be moving nothing. That oxygen sensor is totally dead. So even though it shows heated oxygen sensor, sensor one is a failure in the heater, it's worse than that. It's not doing anything. Now, we want to pray that it's not the computer. It could do that too, but let's try a sensor first. So first you're going to erase the code. It's erasing the code now, and you can see the codes aren't stored. So now the customer brought two oxygen sensors. He didn't know where they come from or whether they fit on this. He got one of them from a junkyard. So what I've done is I've looked up the original parts number on my ALDAT on my phone. These are both Denso sensors, and I cross-referenced it using my phone. I cross-referenced the original number from Honda to the Denso number, and it comes out that this should be the correct one because it has the number 192400, which is what the original one is. Now, of course, it came from a junkyard. It's a gamble. Maybe it'll work, maybe it won't. And to make matters worse, this, as you can see, is an ultra low emissions vehicle. It's got special emissions, meaning special oxygen sensors. If this particular fix doesn't work, he's going to have to go to the Honda dealer and buy their part that was made for this low emissions vehicle if they still stock it. Well, you got to be thorough, so I just Googled it. And of course, the Honda dealers don't stock it. It's such an old car, they can order one. So let's try one of these and keep our fingers crossed. Well, at least this is an easy thing to replace. Check it out. There's only one bank because it's four cylinder, and here's bank one, sensor one. So we're going to swap it out. Like I said though, you got to wash it. This is an ultra low emission vehicle. It's like $365 for the correct one from Honda that they'll have to special order. So let's see what this junkyard special does. All you need is a socket that fits. You can get it in the auto parts store. Then we break it loose, which is always the hard part. There we go. And we'll just twirling it with our fingers, and out it comes. Now, there's something I warn people about all the time. Here's the one that's in it. It's a no-name junker. If I look all around, there is no name. We have no idea who made this, so throw it away. Now, the one he got from a junkyard is a Denso, and it's the 192400. The one that's supposed to fit in it. So in junkyard, we don't know if it works or not, but it's so easy to change. What the heck? Why not take a chance? Simple job of screwing it in. First, we get it finger tight. We get the old socket out, slide it over, and finish the job so it doesn't leak. You absolutely, positively have to have no air leak. If it's loose and it sucks air, it'll give wrong readings. This is measuring residual oxygen in your exhaust. If it's open to the air and air gets inside, it's going to make the readings go bananas. Make sure they're tight, then snap it in. You don't connect it, it won't do anything. Just snaps right in. Click, there we go. Now let's cross our fingers, see what happens. We'll start her up. Well, the light's not on now. Let's see what happens. Well, check the data immediately once it resets itself. Check for trouble codes right away. No freeze frame is stored, okay? So now, let's go to live data. And look, it's starting to remove. Remember how it was stuck in one place? Remember how it was a straight line? Look at that straight line! Baby's going up and down. Now we'll rev it up. See how it changes? It's working. The other one was completely dead. This one's working. Let's hope this junkyard baby holds up. It is used after all. I mean, 360 something bucks for a new one. Worth a try. So we'll take her for a drive and see what happens. Well, so far so good. No check engine light yet. And now we'll take it for a real road test on the highway, because it's got to go through what's called the drive cycle to see if it'll pass the emissions test. So here we go on the highway. You want to go at least 50 miles an hour. This whole thing still runs. Listen to that engine. And while we're driving around, we get to see what's happened to American manufacturing. This is downtown Fall River, where there used to be all kinds of manufacturing jobs, but mainly there seems to be old smokestacks lying around. Now they use it for cell phone towers. Doesn't the world change? Everywhere you look, old abandoned factories. Used to be textiles. Now, they're just abandoned. Though I do have to say, they are rather interesting to look at. Smokestacks everywhere. And it kind of looks like people are even living in this one. Well, people can adapt. I personally find it rather interesting because I grew up in Niagara Falls, where the factories also left. But in Niagara Falls, they tore the old factories down, and now it's just level fields with a few pieces of rubble. Here, they also abandoned the factories, but they just left the rubble standing. All the old buildings are still there. They're just abandoned. Interesting, because really, it's only a stone's throw from the ocean. Beautiful view. No jobs, but beautiful view. Just down the street from the abandoned factories are, you guessed it, brand new homes on the waterfront. Gentrification is taking place everywhere. Well, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Well, we're back here and no check engine light, so let's get the computer out and let's see what it says. No freeze frame data. The only thing flashing is that the EVAP isn't ready yet. Since you can have one mil not ready, this car will now pass the emissions test. So what have we learned? You can fix your own car with a simple scan tool, and do not buy no name, no brand oxygen sensors. It's not worth the hassle. Get the original ones with the correct number. And here's some bonus questions and answers. Carlos Mendez says, what do you think of 2014 Subaru WRX STI hatchback? Good car to buy? Fun cars to drive. They're pretty well built, especially the hatchback versions. But a lot of guys that buy them beat the heck out of them. So if you're talking about buying a used one, you gotta pay a guy like me to check it out before you buy, because you may be buying a car that's falling apart because the previous owner beat the living heck out of them. If you find a middle-aged guy, an older guy like me that's selling one, hey, well, maybe not me, I drive like a maniac, but other old guys that don't drive like maniacs, it could be a good car. If it's a young kid selling it, I'd be kind of leery that it didn't have all the guts knocked out of it. You'd want a guy like me to check it out first, but if it's a good shape, they're fun cars. Nicholas Ryan says, I bought an 05 Infiniti G35X for $4,900 with only 44,000 miles. Did I make a good choice? Well, I never tell people to buy those Infinitis used because they become endless money pits as they age. But if that really positively only has 44,000 miles, you got a good deal, because they don't fall apart till they get 100 something thousand miles on them generally. And with that low mileage, it can last a really long time. As long as it's real. You know, people lie about all kinds of stuff. But let's say it was an elderly person, that's totally believable, because a lot of them don't drive much. Adrian L says, what do you think of daily driving an 81 Mercedes 300 SD Turbo with 96,000 miles? Would it be a reliable vehicle? Well, those were one of the most reliable vehicles ever made. But it's so old, you're going to have to watch for oil leaks, brake seal leaks, cooling system leaks, because all the rubber is going to be old and rotten. But in terms of just driving it, yeah. The only problem is, let's say the rear main seal of your transmission goes out and the transmission fluid starts leaking. You're going to have to pull the transmission off, replace that seal, replace all the other seals. An expensive investment, but I mean, they'll go 400,000 or 500,000 miles. If you don't mind fixing all the rubber stuff, it can run a long time. Fernie Fern says, Scotty, Toyota dealership told me my rear main seal is leaking in my 06 Tundra. Truck has 80,000 original miles and a newer engine with 50,000 miles. Shouldn't this problem only occur at high mileage? Yes, it shouldn't, but I wouldn't believe a word that they say, unless somebody sold you an engine that really didn't have 50,000 miles and it really had 100 or 250 or 350,000 miles, then the seal would be worn out. And they'll tell you you need a new seal. Could be a tiny bit is coming out. If it's not dripping all over the ground, I wouldn't even worry about it. But do what I always do. Buy a bottle of AT205 Reseal. Amazon sells it. Pour it in the engine oil. That can stop it. And if it stops it entirely, every time you change the oil, put that in. And you won't have any more worries. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.